continuing to celebrate his birthday, looking dapper and drinking vodka, that's not water, yeah, is Bruce Apar.
And that's Bazzo. And by the way, the reason I'm wearing this white jacket, Bazzo, where just a couple of weeks ago, a couple of shows ago, I was wearing a scarf and a
hat.
That's
right.
This is our first show, folks, of spring.
And you're also the 106-year-old man.
And
which
by the
you
way,
can explain.
We still haven't done our opener. And he's Bazzo, and you're watching Bruce the Blog Goes Bazzo.
Good evening, everybody. We have a great guest tonight.
Sandy, how long have you been in the...
Action in Albany. It's not a dull place.
I feel like we're really accomplished.
Okay, everybody. Right, yeah. Welcome to Bruce the Blog Goes Bazzo.
So you almost caught us unawares there. And we do want to welcome our special guest, Assemblywoman Sandy Galiff of the 90th District. Sandy,
yes,
welcome
great to
as
be
always.
Here.
It's good to have you, Sandy.
And one of the things a lot of people know about, hello, you're over there, about Assemblywoman Galiff, because as we were just saying, she has been in the Assembly for 20 years, is that she insists on being called Sandy, and that's just a reflection of how accessible she is and why she keeps getting reelected, actually.
You have two TV shows, being that we're on Cablevision.
Yes.
What are the two shows?
Well, I have Speak Out with Sandy Galiff, and that's basically about state issues. And then I have Dear Sandy, which is trying to involve the community, people that are in the community and what they're doing. So
and they can be found on your local public access channels
right.
in your area.
Yes,
just
absolutely.
Check your cable guide.
Thank
yeah.
you.
Yeah.
Yes, okay.
And
I'm
so
sorry,
quick,
Bruce.
That's fine. Quickly, the salute of the week, Bazzo. Yeah, I know that too. But let me do the salute first,
okay.
Then we'll, you know, we'd like to switch things around and
okay.
keep everybody off guard, most of all ourselves.
Yeah.
The salute of the week, without getting into too much detail, because we could spend at least 30 minutes on this topic, the affordable housing settlement in Westchester County, County Executive Astorino, pretty much since he's been in office, has been tangling with the federal housing
urban development
agency over the conditions of the agreement, the original agreement, which the county executive feels they changed midstream after the county agreed, you know, to put in affordable housing on certain terms. He vetoed legislation called source of income legislation because he felt it was totally violated the spirit of the agreement. And he ended up winning a ruling just recently. This was just within the last week or so, that says that basically a housing monitor, and this is where sometimes government gets a little funky, the housing monitor in the battle between HUD and the county was selected by HUD. I mean, saying HUD sounds like the radio station, let's call it HUD, which sounds like a movie starring Paul Newman. So no matter what you say, it's confusing. Anyhow, the Housing Urban Development Agency chose the housing monitor who, what a surprise, ruled in its favor. And then this magistrate overturned it. And ruled basically in favor of the county executive and that the source of income legislation is not really, as he said, valid. And one of the points he made is that would have made the housing less affordable and less available, you know. Mm. So we're saluting him for fighting that battle and actually winning it. And then you have a salvo, Bazzo.
Well, yes. This is to the I Hate Eric DeBartolo fan club.
Well, you have to explain who he is because
Eric DeBartolo is the Yorktown Highway Superintendent
for many years.
For many years,
right.
And he has been pursued the last number of years by a group of people who don't like him and they want him out of office, and they accuse him of a lot of nefarious deeds.
Right.
And they have tried with locally, statewide audit, county, and then they've tried with the feds, and they've gotten nowhere, because it's the same old story time and time again. And they've gotten nowhere. Now they went for civil action, forcing the town of Yorktown to pay for a lawyer to defend Eric. And their thing was they were doing this for Yorktown. And now that we have to pay for another lawyer on something that has had no traction in the past because of their petty personal grievances, they're like little crybabies, they're doing it to Yorktown. Get over it, because now it's been jumped to a federal case. It's no longer a civil case where the preponderance of the evidence doesn't hold true now. Now it's reasonable doubt. And so it's also going to be a more expensive, costly lawyer for Yorktown. And I want to salvo them, because get over it, you cost us enough money. You couldn't make your case at any level yet, other than some naughty thing, some stuff that would probably be a slap on the wrist and a naughty, naughty, don't do it again. It's done. Get over it. Go home.
And just one quick thing, a postscript. Like, you know, this show goes out to a lot of different communities and people. Bazzo is referencing the Yorktown Highway Superintendent. However, a lot of you watching may know him because Eric DiBartolo is widely regarded as, you know, at least a countywide, if not further, expert on infrastructure, logistics, and maintenance. So he's often interviewed on News 12 when storms come up and they want some expert. You know,
absolutely, yeah. Yes.
So his name might be familiar. Anyhow, so Sandy, the first thing I want to ask.
Bruce.
You know, if Bazza wasn't here, I probably would self-destruct.
Forget the penny saver.
Well, not forget it, but anyhow, we are brought to you by Chase Media Group, best known as publisher of The Penny Saver, and Carla Chase, the CEO, and Frank Rich, who run the company. But we do a lot of other things, and so we always want to
thank you for putting up with us, as always.
Right. And
one quick thing. Yeah. And I do, sorry, Sandy. I called you the 106-year-old man. Tell him what I meant, because this is great news.
All
this
is
great
news. He's not referring to...
our shameless promotion segment.
He's not referring to Mel Brooks and Carl Ryan, or what was that?
2,000-year-old man.
Right. Yeah. I'm a babe in the woods compared to them. 106 years old. My friend Barry Liebman of Yorktown Stage... just after I was cast in another show, Neil Simon's Fools, by the Armonk Players, that'll be coming up in June. Then Barry Liebman calls me, and to my amazement and gratification, says he needs somebody to replace an actor who had to drop out of A Funny Thing Happened on the Way to the Forum. That's mid-April at Yorktown Stage. You can go on their website.
Yes, this is.
And the character is a 106-year-old man. And it's a funny, it's a small but funny part that was played in the movie by Buster Keaton.
What's the character's name?
Erroneous.
Now, is it true that you're not going to need any makeup for this?
Well, that remains to be seen, Bazzo. I mean, it depends who you ask. lately, with some of the comments on the blog, maybe I'm better off in disguise.
So, okay, let's go right to our guest.
Anyhow, let's go right to our guest.
Sounds like a wonderful show.
Yeah, thank you, Sandy. But, Sandra, seriously, and then not so seriously, the first question I have, but, you know, this, you know, political correctness is sort of always in the news, right?
Yeah.
And lately, what do you prefer? Is it assemblywoman, assembly person, assembly member? Because isn't that sort of changing a little bit?
Well, you know, it's interesting. I was the person, and probably Andy would dispute this, to have the constitutional amendment out there for people to vote on, and that happened in 2011, to make our state constitution gender neutral. Because the Constitution of the state of New York was all about men, no women. So now it's all been changed, and actually any laws that we pass are gender neutral.
Actually, I had no opinion one way or the other on it. It was off my radar. It didn't matter to me how it was done.
All right. Well, you know, there were a lot of people that, you know, were lieutenant governors, and they were women, and they were never referred to, and the head of our state court then, Betsy, and then Judith Kay. Judith Kay. And, you know, you've had a lot of other women and women in the assembly who were assemblymen. So after that, I think I preferred to be assemblywoman or member of the assembly, one or the other.
Right.
I don't like to be called assemblyman.
No, I don't blame you.
So, anyway, but it's whatever works.
Okay, so let's jump into, I know Bazzo's been champing at the bit to jump into some juicy issues.
Well, the first thing we're going to do is Tier 6. We had your best student, Kathy Borgia, as our guest last week. And we were taught what it meant for the counties, which was nothing, because there's no savings right now.
Not yet.
I know, but what I wrote in my column that's
yes,
out.
Yes, I saw your column, right.
Is that nothing is carved in stone, and tiers 2 through 5, because Kathy Borges admitted her tier 4 was bumped up during Pataki to what it wasn't originally intended to be. And so what is to stop this tier from becoming a meaningless gesture again, other than for headlines, the next legislative
session? And I think we need to put in context, right, which I'm always trying to, as he knows, yes, trying to correct course, so to speak, that we're talking about pension reform, right?
Right. Pension reform for all public employees.
And we did
pass the Tier 6. One of the things that would answer your question is, we have stated that if there's an increase in any of it, that the state would pay for it.
But who's the state?
The state is us.
Right.
It
was like with the MTA, repealing the MTA tax, but the state's going to give the MTA $250,000, which the state took from the MTA over two years under Patterson.
Right. But as a small business owner, doesn't have to pay it now.
Yes,
right?
I do. I still got to pay my taxes.
No, but are you paying your MTA? No, you're not paying.
Yes,
that.
Well, actually, I am on every gallon of gas on my cell phone.
No, I know.
That was the ridiculous argument for the MTA, a separate source of income. They have multiple sources of income from the tax that are supposed to be separate from everything else.
Right. I would hope that in the future we can keep getting rid of that MTA commuter tax and not have to fund it in another way. You know, as more and more people, you know, during the economy, people were not traveling. They had lost jobs. They weren't going to the city. So the revenues for our mass transit were down. Now, as things are progressing in a more positive way, hopefully, you know, we'll have more people paying for the service so that people don't have to pay
taxes. Right, but although, you know, that, it's sort of like in the case of the MTA, you know, payroll tax and all, in a lot of cases, it's sort of like charging me a cigarette tax when I don't smoke cigarettes, right? Right. I mean, a lot of people will never step foot on mass transit.
See, that's the most annoying thing about it, that there are people that pay a tax on their cell phone, on their cable, and on the numerous things that will never ride the train in their lives, and they don't derive a benefit from it.
Right, I never voted for the tax in the first place, as you know.
See, I know that, but I understood school taxes, whether you have children or not, because that is a betterment, and you do need this. But to punish people that don't use the service, because it's a specific service.
I agree with you.
Yeah. Okay, but what about, we got off.
But anyway, go back to tier six.
Right.
What is
right.
So there really is nothing to stop than this thing that the state's going to pay from monkeying around with it to curry favor from the unions, because you have a couple of things in there that got me nuts. According to Bill Hammond, either Mayor Bloomberg or Andrew Cuomo could change it without even consulting the legislature.
No,
according
to
him, yes.
That's not true. What do they suggest that they can change? Because we passed, we changed the.
This is what it
says. The age when you retire.
This is what it says.
62 to 63.
It says buried inside this. It's Bill Hammond from the Daily News. He's a
columnist.
Yes, buried inside this complicated 40-page piece of legislation were causes and loopholes that undercut the stated purpose of reforming a broken pension system. The nastiest surprise was language empowering Cuomo and Mayor Bloomberg to enhance benefits in certain ways on their own without consulting either the council, the legislature, or the city council.
Well, maybe that. I wonder if that's police and fire, because police and fire in New York City were left out of the pension plan for Tier 6.
But not the police and fire anywhere else in the state.
But I wonder if that's an arrangement that they're going to try to renegotiate with them on some aspect of their retirement services. I don't really know the answer to that. I'll look into it. But
I'll give you this.
But otherwise,
when
we did Tier 5, we had to pass the legislation. That came under Governor Patterson.
Right.
And a few people are in Tier 5 that have been hired in the last 2 years, but there aren't a lot of people in it. Now we have a Tier 6, which will start with new hires.
But we have a Tier 6 because everybody monkeyed around with 2 through 5. Right. I mean,
The Tier 6 means that public employees are going to have to pay more into their pension plan.
Future.
Future public employees. It doesn't impact employees
current,
today.
Right, right.
Because the Constitution of the State of New York says you can't diminish.
Well, why don't they do a constitutional amendment to change that?
Well, I mean,
if you really want reform, that's where you would go.
Right. You'd have to do that. But remember, when we had a chance for the public to do a whole constitutional convention in about 97, the public voted no on it.
Yeah,
you know, every 20 years it comes
years.
Back.
Right.
I know, but it's going to be up again now in 5 years. Every 20 years it's on the ballot for the public to say whether they want to have a constitutional convention and look at all of these issues.
Yes.
And people voted no for whatever reason. Everybody gets nervous about everything, whether you're environmentalist, whether you're union.
Well, because it opens
whatever
up,
it is.
It does open up the entire
constitution. It opens up the whole thing.
And that scares the heck out of me.
Now, okay,
I just want to continue on a different part of this.
Well, what I was going to say is
we want to move along
to other topics.
So yes, I want to get on the other topic. The other part was the 401k plan.
That is...
The legislatures can access, but people non-union can access it. But are you saying that the people in the unions are too stupid that they can't choose their own protection?
The unions. It was very interesting because we got a lot of letters from union people, and they were up in Albany lobbying us, particularly against the 401k plan. But remember, the governor had it as an optional plan.
Right.
And I didn't have a problem with it, but a lot of people had a problem with it as an optional plan. So what happened in the compromise was that from now on, the 401k-like plan is available to non-union people making over $75,000 a year. So that was the compromise. And, you know, that was just to get enough votes. And you know how many, it was it was a real struggle to get votes in the assembly for two.
And like I said, this is funny for something that doesn't affect anybody now.
No, but what was happening is we were getting phone calls from everybody saying, it's going to affect us now in the pension plan. We say, no, this is for new people.
This is the future.
And it's not about you, but people were very, very nervous.
Okay, now what was in the news this week? We're changing the topic. What was in the news this week? I trust you. You said we were going to change the topic.
Okay, I can't wait to hear what it is.
The union said we are ceasing endorsements and giving money because of this vote. Cuomo says you may get a knock on the door from the inspector general on this one, the attorney general on this one, because that's like pay to play and it's illegal.
Oh, the advertisements in the Legislative Gazette, which is the Albany little paper that the interns up in Albany work on, and it's really good. But they had two ads, and they were saying, you know, that they're going to look at everybody who voted for this, Tier 6, and they're going to, either evaluate whether they'll give out any endorsements. It was a little bit of a threat,
off
I would say.
Camera, you said it was fun working under this new governor. It's moments like this that have to make it fun because he's going right back in their face and not being intimidated.
Well, you know, Governor Cuomo is thinking about our future of our state. First of all, we don't have a lot of money, so we've been having to cut back. Governor Patterson knew that too. He was there. We've made tremendous cuts in our budget. But we're also thinking about the future, and you start to see that some of the California communities are going bankrupt. We don't want that to happen with us, and the pension is becoming one of the largest parts of any of our municipal budgets.
But that is actually standing up.
And he's standing up.
That's got to make it fun.
Okay. Anyway, ding, ding, ding.
Okay.
You know what that is? If anybody watches,
can we go?
If anybody watches, pardon the interruption, on ESPN. We should invoke that format. They actually allocate a certain number of seconds to each topic, and they go, ding, 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 next topic. So hydraulic fracturing. We don't have a bell yet, so I'm the ding-dong. Hydraulic fracturing, Sandy, which has been abbreviated, I might add, to sound like a fraternity hazing ritual. Hydrofracking. I'd hate to be
hydrofracking.
I'd hate to be hydrofracked pledging a fraternity. But... So what's your view and your experience so far?
Well, that's that fracking going down in the earth and then horizontal to try to get out our gas and everything.
Right.
Well, I actually had a visit a month and a half ago into Pennsylvania, into Wanda, where they have a lot of hydrofracking. to meet with people there. We met with some people that were a part of the cooperative extension in Pennsylvania. They seemed to be supportive of it with a lot of qualifiers. We met with somebody who had their home totally destroyed, had to leave it. It was an individual that got very sick because of hydrofracking. She'd given permit for the mineral rights for a company to work right behind her house. It went down, affected her well and her water. So we have two sides of the story. My position after that is we have to keep a moratorium going until we know really what's happening with fracking, because we have both sides. I'm actually having two town meetings. We're going to show the film.
Right.
We interviewed everybody out there, tried to do it in a very bipartisan way. I'm going to have two films in April, one on a Friday night. I think it's like the 29th of April, and then on the 22nd on a Sunday, and just get people's opinion of what they see.
So you commissioned the video while you were there, basically?
No, we took our own cameras.
Okay. Oh, so you did your own.
We did our own cameras. Right. We wanted to go with the one of the companies that were working there, but they said we had to sign off on any liability, and to tell you the truth, we were advised not to do that by the Assembly Council.
We went on site,
but
and you got
without
both
permission.
Sides. You got both sides of the issue.
We got both sides of the issue. Right. We got both sides
but a
of
lot
issue.
Of the stuff that they talk about that happened in Pennsylvania happened in the beginning before they tightened up under Rendell. The environmental rules for hydrofracking. Yeah. Yes, that's the topic we're on.
No, I'm saying how long ago did it start in Pennsylvania? Is my
question. Must be 15, 20 years ago.
It's been
ago.
That long?
It's been a while.
Yes, but until Rendell became governor, so you got all these horror stories, and that happened long before, because now they've changed the environmental rules for the protection, and now they haven't had any of these problems that happened in the past.
Well, but I visited the house where the problem had occurred in the last couple of years, and it was a woman that got very, very sick, very worried because she also had a baby and drinking the water in her house and didn't know what the impact would be.
From regulations that
I don't understand why the company didn't come back and just help this woman. I don't get.
It sounds like Erin Brockovich, doesn't it? The movie Erin Brockovich and her experience.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
That's what it sounds like.
Anything done by man comes with certain risks.
Oh, it does. Absolutely.
The fact is, your own DEC and the federal DEC have said this is fine. This new technology changes the equation. They've been more than public about
this.
Fine. And it's more than change the equation. And you have a whole section of this state that's dying economically, dying. And this could help revitalize it.
But you have diversity even within that area, Andy, with people that want it and people that don't. And what I found in Pennsylvania was that the company started out to get the big acreage first and have those owners sign on. And then once it happened, it was kind of like, I thought, a group mentality where everybody signed on because they knew it would impact them anyway. That even if they didn't sign on for the mineral rights, their neighbors were. And there was going to be the impact of the trucks. I mean, we saw lots of trucks. We saw trucks with water in them.
Right.
And you're wondering what
those
it says pure water
those were the things that
on.
Changed under the new regulations.
But it was still, but that was still going on, you know, when I was there. And they also gave people different amounts for their property. Some got, you know, just like $100 an acre, and some got $5,000 an acre.
The railroad did that when they were building railroads. I mean, that hasn't changed over the years.
Right. Right.
Well, people who hold out get
but
more
I
money, right?
Right.
That's what happens.
This has been discussed long enough. It's time for action. Yep. People are hurting now. It's funny. You have a resource now that can literally drive down the price of natural gas, and all of a sudden, we can't have that. We have to keep the price up high by putting artificial roadblocks in the process of, again, developing another fossil fuel. And this is driving me crazy because real people suffer.
Mm-hmm. But even in Tawanda, The companies were leaving because they went back, they're going to Ohio because they could get wet gas out of Ohio, which I guess is better than dry gas in Pennsylvania. So we were seeing a lot of abandoned wells because they went off somewhere else. But, so even them, they weren't getting the gas out of there.
We're pretending that from the start,
okay.
The New York environmental codes are as weak as all these other states. We're four times stricter just from the starting gate than everybody else.
And we're going to run out of gas sooner than you think. So yes, ding, ding, ding. Okay. Redistricting, I know one of your...
No, I want to go with photo ID.
Let's take a vote.
I want to go with photo ID, because that's been in the news. Eric Holder.
All right.
Eric Holder, the Attorney General of the United
States. I
bow
to Bazo. Go ahead. Photo ID.
Only because Eric...
That's fine. Go ahead.
Just for giving you the background. Eric Holder is suing all the states on behalf of the United States government that are trying to require photo ID for voting, to prove that who you are when you vote.
What is he saying? It's a constitutional
violation? He's saying it stigmatizes poor elderly and minorities, the same thing that Steve Katz got when he proposed it in New York. He says it's bringing us, Holder says it's bringing us back to the days of Jim Crow.
Okay.
And
so what's the question for our guests is...
I don't think it's going to pass in New York, frankly. It's not going to pass
and
in New York.
Requiring photo ID.
Right, requiring photo ID. But let me ask you something, Andy, because I've thought about it. How do you do... Okay, so... all of us would have to go in and show photo ID every time we wanted to vote. And,
like,
you
when
know,
we buy beer.
Right,
when we
buy
beer.
Actually, sometimes they let me pass where they put a coat in. She's got white hair.
Right, I understand. Okay. Well, I'm using that as an example.
Anyway, you're right.
But you're saying...
And even when a liquor store, they don't... I don't think at a liquor store. I mean, they look at you at the age, but they don't require you over a certain age to buy liquor.
It depends on the store's
policy.
Right, right.
There are some stores, because of where they're located, it's a blanket policy.
Right, right. But a certain age, I've never been asked in a liquor store.
Well,
But certainly the supermarket for beer.
You want to open a bank account. You need it. You want to fly, you need it. You want to rent a house, buy a house, you need it.
Right. So you're saying, basically, Bazo, you think voting is the exception.
They're making it an exception, and I'm saying, why?
Right.
Voting is a more sacred thing than all these other actions combined.
What do you do with absentee ballots? Say I have to vote on my school budget or school issues. I have to vote absentee because it's always on a Tuesday and I'm always in Albany. So for the last number of years, I've always gotten an absentee ballot. So are you telling me that I can't really vote absentee because I can't prove I've got to go?
To be honest,
and
on camera, I've never filled out an absentee ballot. I don't even know what one looks like.
Well, it actually asks you to write down where you're going to be and why you're out of town. I'm trying to correct that because I think that's invading
while you're out of town.
Yes, I have to write down, you know, what business I'm in, why am I out of town, why can't
it's
I?
It's like a customs question,
when
you come
terrible.
Back from
yes.
out of the country.
And I got it changed in our regular absentee ballot, but not for schools. But so how does somebody with an absentee ballot ever prove that they're who they are?
Yeah, right.
I think
you know, you're going to have a two-tier system.
I think there are more people that vote in person than do absentees. That's
but
number
that's
one.
Not, that doesn't answer the question.
The people that are going to go in
that are not qualified to vote are going to do absentee. So how are you going to get around this?
Oh, that's easy. You make sure they're notarized. That's easy enough. You have
so
to
somebody
do,
has to get an absentee ballot, go to
if
a notary,
they're already got,
pay
they don't,
a
wait
dollar.
A second. They already went to get the absentee ballot, so we already know they're moving. They're out of their house.
Okay.
No. Yeah, I'm not out of my house when I get an absentee ballot. Right. I'm on the job in Albany. I can't be here locally.
No, but we know they had to somehow get that ballot.
I had to go. I have to go to the school board.
Right.
I have to pick up
you
the ballot.
Had to go to
the,
and so when we have to go, too, by the way. And I vote to wrap it up.
Let's just keep taping.
We were just having a good time.
Let's just keep taping.
Okay, right.
Anyway, these were my opinion. You may beg to differ.
And when Bruce the Blog listens, people, including our good friend, Assembly member, Sandy Galef, talk.
Sandy,
thanks for watching, everybody.
We know her well enough. We can call her.
Didn't I say Sandy?
Right. Yes, you did.
Yes thank you.
Did. Yes.
Anyway, I hope you had a good time.
Thank you very much. I had a great time. call on me again.
Yeah, no, we will. No, absolutely.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Oh, yes.
Yep.
Was a good
show. There's a lot to talk about.
Right. Was they too?
That tier six is just so controversial.